I felt Fellini had left something unsaid that could be said in 8 and a half. He was very focused on his main character. He was very focused on the point of view of his main character, very focused on doing this extraordinary thing, which was to portray the world of the past, the present, and fantasy simultaneously, which works brilliantly on film and I think even better on stage, because the theater is a magic box and you make anything happen simply with words. I thought that one of the things that was left to be said was hearing from these extraordinary women who were left in the detritus of, in the wake of Guido's path. I mean, he ran through these women like a lawnmower. Well, what about them? What are they thinking? Why would they put up with it? And so I began to see not only Guido as a stone skipping across the water, having to skip faster and faster, otherwise he sinks, which he ultimately does, but also as a man who desperately loves women at the same time relies on them but exploits them. He's a cad, but there's something lovable about him nevertheless, and he has to get his comeuppance. But I wanted to hear from those women. And so, and I don't think it's accidental that would occur to me during the time when Ms. Magazine was being founded and our society was changing. I think this was simply in the air. And so I had an opportunity to write for very strong, very powerful female characters in a way that possibly could expand in music and lyrics the themes that Fellini had given us in 8 and a half. I also felt that there were things in the film that couldn't possibly work on stage. One of which was the principal denouement of the movie, in which Guido insults and embarrasses his wife by having her see these film tests of women that he's casting to play his wife and revealing terrible secrets about his marriage to the world. And I realized, you know, from the third balcony of the St. James, nobody's going to see that. That's just going to be too small. We didn't have gigantic projections in the theater in those days. And then I thought, well, then I need another way. And I thought, well, what if I make him sufficiently different? First of all, he's not simply a film director. He's also an actor. He's also a singer. He also writes music, like Charlie Chaplin or Clint Eastwood. And in fact, he's actually doing a musical movie. And so his musical movie could be Casanova. After all, I had already done some research and work on Casanova. There it was. I predicted, in fact, it was prescient, because several years after I'd written that, Fellini actually did do a movie based on Casanova. And in fact, it really was it was an actual flop, or to him, not a creative flop. I think it's a masterpiece. But there it was. And so from the kind of wonderful obsession and love and freedom that I had, I launched into 9, into making all the changes that I thought I could make. Instead of his insulting his wife with the screen test, I had him write an opera based on the life of Casanova as kind of his flop movie, and have him embarrass her, even to the point where then I could start doing things that come from the tradition of the classical world. I mean, there are parody masses in the history of classical music, in which you take a popular melody and you bring it into the church. Mm-hmm. And in the same way, there's a song, a deeply felt song in the first act called Only With You, in which Guido sings in his mind to three different women. And then I thought, well, then if he's doing his opera and he wants to reveal that, maybe he could do Only you will I ever see, forever will you be. Oh, that's very interesting. So the audience would recognize that as, oh my God, now he's taking Only With You, which was this intimate moment with his wife, and he's putting it out there before the whole world and literally confessing that he's having a relationship with three women at the same time, which enrages her. That was the first wave of the creation of 9. No new love, no new love, and you will be my true love. No new love, no new love.